I'd like to thank Doug. I'd like to thank Joan Cable, who also has been integral in this process, as has Dr. Sean Faulkner, who you may have seen earlier this year. I think you'll also catch him on C-SPAN this weekend, where they will be showing one of his lectures from an earlier symposium that we hosted November 3 and 4. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to wrap up my talking, but I would encourage you in just a little bit, about an hour or so, to have some of your own talking. And you'll notice on either side there are microphones. And at the end of our lecture this evening, we would invite you to come down and ask questions from either one. I'll start that Q&A session. And then we'll have both of our speakers tonight. They'll come back up and we'll be able to answer those questions. Also, in a modern era of wireless communication, and you can thank Edwin Armstrong for some of his work during World War I for this lovely little device right here. But if you haven't, could you take it out and go ahead and put that onto mute? And then don't be afraid to use it. Take pictures, take notes, shoot out some things on social media. On Twitter, we are at theworldwar.org. All right, I think that is my housekeeping, and the stage goes to the main event. We are so privileged to be joined this evening by Dr. Sean Kalic, a professor in the Department of Military History at the United States Army Command and General Staff College, who has lectured and published widely on topics such as the interwar period, 1919 to 1939, the Cold War, the post-Cold War security environment, and transnational terrorism. Some of his publications include Thinking About War, Past, Present, and Future. Okay, that is a really compelling title, and I read a lot of titles. And most recently, he has edited The Russian Revolution and Russian Civil War, An Essential Reference. We're also proudly joined by Dr. Gates Brown, who is an assistant professor of military history at the United States Army Command and General Staff College, where he specializes in the early Cold War period with a focus on U.S. nuclear and defense policy. He is also a co-editor of The Russian Revolution, 1917, The Essential Reference Guide, which I know that many of our guests here are eagerly waiting to hear more about. So, if you will please join me in welcoming Dr. Sean Kalic.
Thank you. Tonight's lecture is going to probably be a little different than what you're used to because we're co-authors of a book. Although we're both Cold War historians, they figured it's Soviets, communists, you guys could do easy Russian Revolution stuff. So what we're going to do is something a bit different. That I know that the lecture series is supposed to focus on World War I and its aftermath, but essentially what we're going to do is talk about the Russian Revolution and really systemic problems within Russia itself and how that revolution in 1917 that we all come to know and love as the Bolshevik Revolution in October of 1917, how it builds really from 1881 on up to 1917. So I get the pleasure of having to cover 1881 to 1917, roughly, really 1905, and then Gates gets to come up and kind of handle the good Russian Revolution stuff. So bear with us, and then we'll both ask questions or answer questions. I want to thank CGSC Foundation, of course, for putting on the lecture series, the National World War I Museum, which is a fantastic place. My daughter loves it here, and this is the first time I've been in the auditorium, but lots of time spent out and around. So without further ado, here we go. So, and again, as historians, we tend to talk about long historical arcs, right? So rather than just talking about October 1917, we'll start with our Tsar Alexander II, who's the guy laying dead in the center right there, who is the Tsar who really, he starts to bring Russia into the modern age, the early modern age. In fact, he's going to be the guy who gets rid of serfdom, and his issue is that he wants to slowly change Russia to a more industrialized society and get rid of some of the old trappings of kind of 17th, 16th century Russia. So his famous phrase is, I want to change Russia from the top and not allow it to kind of percolate from the bottom, which is essentially, he doesn't want a revolution. Second, are going to have opportunities, and they think they're handling the social, political, economic stress in the Russian system. And from their perspective on high, they are. The problem is, from the people's perspective, the workers' perspective, the peasants' perspective, they're not. So the Tsars believe they're giving a little bit, because again, as a Tsar, you don't want to give up your power, right? No one likes giving up absolute power. So we'll see this idea of there are opportunities where they think they are making great strides and slowly changing and controlling the way Russia isn't going to move into the 20th century, but ultimately the pressure from the bottom is ultimately going to get them and just kind of blow up in their faces. Okay? So that's where we're going. Let's start with Alexander II, which we talked about. He's a guy who's going to get rid of the serfs. He's going to start industrialization. He's going to start these independent regional governments called zemstvos, which is really a local government designed to kind of manage the peasants. Now, if you're a peasant, that sounds fantastic, but the reality is you can only be elected as zemstvo if you're a landowner or part of the gentry society. So if you're a peasant, although you're no longer a serf, you are still on the lowest rung of the socioeconomic ladder, by the way. And the zemstvos are designed to handle land issues, medical supplies, and really distribute food and other issues as Russia goes through systemic economic crises and famine with food. So again, Alexander II does some good things, but again, he's all about slow control because he doesn't want this thing to kind of spiral out of control as Europe has seen from 1848 on. The problem is that there's a group of, and on the right there, just have a pointer on it, right? Is a wood carving of the assassination of Alexander II, which happens in 1881. He's assassinated by a group called the People's Will, or Will of the People, depending on how you translate the Russian. And the assassination is really done because the people on the bottom want more rapid change. They want a voice in the government, they want a voice in society, and they're tired of being suppressed by the gentry, the nobles, and the elite. So although Alexander II thinks he's making these changes, ultimately the people, right, the people on the bottom, the man's keeping them down. The man is right here, right? And the ultimate objective is to, if we get rid of him, we'll start this spontaneous revolution. So what we'll see is this kind of starts and fits of revolutionary processes. And I'll argue that in 1881 is the first attempt to kind of get rid of the Tsar and bring the system down. But Alexander's son, Alexander III, is going to have something to say about that. Now, what's interesting is the group that assassinates Alexander II, the Will of the People or the People's Will, how many of you heard of Vladimir Ilyich Lenin? Lots of you. We're not going to talk about a lot today, by the way. His brother is part of the Will of the People. So he's part of this organization. Ultimately, he's going to end up getting thrown in prison and then essentially killed by this guy, which is going to start Lenin on a unique path towards revolution. So everything in Russia is kind of related, by the way, the long memories. So in 1881, March, Alexander III is going to assume the throne from his father, who has been assassinated. And again, his father's kind of known as a guy who's a little bit progressive, but again, still wants to maintain the power. And Alexander III is going to kind of maintain that same mentality in Russia from 1881 until he's going to die prematurely, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And his idea really is to kind of maintain his father's idea of slow social economic change. But again, if you're on the bottom, it's not going to be fast enough or broad enough. However, his first act, his first major act as Tsar, is in the summer of 1881. He's going to institute these temporary regulations. Now, if you know anything about the Soviet Union, they have a very strong police system, right? The KGB, they tend to crack down on people. They do heinous things to them, throw them in gulags, kill them, all kinds of fun stuff, right? You guys know this, right? It's not a happy-go-lucky place, typically. Part of this starts under the Tsars, by the way, specifically Tsar Alexander III. And these temporary regulations are part of this. The idea is to suppress any public dissent. So it gives the government absolute power over really preserving state security. So depending on what you're writing, what you're talking about, what you're saying, what you're meeting about, I can suppress you, which means throw you in jail, maybe shoot you. That depends on how heinous it is, how threatening it is to the stability of the regime. And it controls all elements of society. So any kind of First Amendment rights that you think you may have are completely suppressed because Tsar Alexander wants a nice, steady, orderly government. So anything you say that is deemed to be inappropriate or questionable to the stability of the regime is used against you. So who makes this determination? Not you. He does, and his staff, by the way. So again, top-down change. Now, what's interesting is that although he has this heavy-handed element, right, and these are supposed to be temporary to kind of stamp out Will of the People and some other anarchist organizations that are hanging around Russia trying to promote change, he believes he's going to do something nice now. So he has the heavy hand, And what's next is this idea of I'm going to do some social political engineering to help kind of, you know, the people get along. So what we'll see is both Alexander III and Nicholas II kind of have dualistic personalities. They'll do something kind of heavy-handed and heinous, but on the other hand, they'll say, okay, but, you know, sometimes you just need some tough love, but ultimately I'm going to do some changes for you too. So they don't want to be bad guys, they don't want to be good guys, just kind of right in the middle. So what Alexander III is going to do here, and you can see this great painting of him being, you know, welcomed by his people, is that he's going to change the social conditions, because as Russia industrializes in the late 1880s and 1890s, you have an influx of peasants coming into larger cities. So his idea, it really is, let's set some basic limitations. The first major limitation is that workers coming from the fields into these industrialized societies or industrialized cities and industrial parks, the guys that own the industry have absolute power over the workers. So if you're late for work, I get to fine you. In fact, I may take your whole month's pay, by the way, and there's nothing you can do about it. Not a good deal, right? Right? Yeah. You can't buy a new phone, right? You're just out of luck. And the czar kind of agrees that, okay, maybe that's too much power, so what we'll do is we'll kind of, you know, make sure the workers have some grievance or some means to say, okay, the factory owners can't levy a substantial fine on you and take all your pay. So they have to have kind of, they can fine you still, but it can't be a grievous fine, which you'll see right here, right? And the workers can start to form some unions, so they have some ability to, you know, collectively talk about, okay, what's an excessive fine, what isn't, but the power is still held at the industrial level by the owner, but again, there's a check on it by the government. So that kind of makes the workers feel kind of good, right? It's a step in the right direction, but it's not a huge step. The other two ideas really are textile reform for women and children. So if you're a mother and you have children, you can't work the midnight shift, which is fantastic, right? So you get to stay home with the kids, but you can work all day, by the way. And again, I think what you'll see is, from the czar's perspective, he is making big gains here, right? And the third one you see up there is a limitation on work days on children 12 to 15. So he puts them in an 8-hour work day. So again, you guys can still go to school, but after school, guess what? You can go work in the factory for 8 hours. Not a bad deal. At least you're home by midnight, right? With your mother, by the way, which is good. So again, as we look at this period with Alexander III, he believes he's maintaining control with the temporary regulations, which aren't temporary, by the way. They were designed originally to last 3 months. They're going to last throughout at least 1905. So they're going to have a long lifespan. And he believes that's holding the people in check, but he's also allowing these kind of social political ideas to kind of permeate and give kind of slow, controlled reform to the system. Because the last thing the czar wants is quick, active reform. He wants everybody to be cool, right? It's that kind of Pulp Fiction moment, everybody be cool, honey bunny, right? He wants everybody to be cool, all right? The problem is that throughout the 1890s, there are significant problems in Russia. In 1891 and 92, there's a massive famine. It's going to affect about 20 million people throughout Russia. 400,000 are going to ultimately die of the famine. So that creates tension because, again, these zemstvos that I talked about, Alexander II allowed to happen, they're controlled by the landed gentry and other nobles, essentially. So if you have a surplus of grain and you can sell it on the market or you can give it to the people that are starving, what are you going to do with it? No, you're going to give it to the people that need it, right? No, you're going to sell it for money. So, again, if you're on the bottom, you always believe you're getting kind of the wrong end of the stick. And again, the czar isn't doing much to handle those type of issues. So when 400,000 of your countrymen die because of improper management, that's going to create issues as well. So as we move through the 1890s, Alexander is not a bad guy. He maintains his temporary regulations, which is the iron fist, but he also empowers these zemstvos here. And the problem is that if you're on the bottom, he has lots of power, these guys have lots of power, and you, the peasant right here, have minimal power. Now, at least he allowed you, you know, you can't have an excessive fine, and your kids don't have to work, you know, 24 hours a day, and your wife and children could be home, you know, in the wee hours of the morning. So it's something at least, right? So again, that's one of those off-ramps. The czar believes he's doing something to slowly cultivate and change society, but the reality is that if you're on the bottom, if you're a worker, it's giving you, you know, this much when you really want this much. Alexander III is going to die prematurely in November 1894. He's only 49 years old, which is pretty significant. Czars in this era tend to live 60, 70, by the way. The stress and strain on the job tends to be credited as one of the things that kind of prematurely kills him. So essentially a heart attack, which is significant. Now, his son's going to assume the throne. And Nicholas II is going to be the last Tsar of Russia. Now, everyone thinks Nicholas is a really good guy. He's a great family man. He loves his wife. He loves his children. You know, by all accounts, is a good guy. Everyone likes to have him around. He's not sarcastic. Kind of knows what he's talking about and has some foreign affairs experience. But the problem is, he just really isn't the guy you want in charge because he's kind of indecisive. So, you know, good guy, but not the guy you want to call at 3 in the morning with a critical issue because he's not going to make an answer. He's not going to give you an impromptu answer. He's going to have to kind of mull it over, talk to a bunch of people, think about it, you know, give you another week, think about it some more, which is going to be a problem because as Russia moves into the 20th century, more and more of these social political pressures are going to start to kind of percolate up, largely from what his father has left him with. So what his father has left him with is a really kind of a stressful environment. Temporary regulations are going to be maintained, so he has to do the same kind of harsh repression of any threat to the regime, whether it be organized labor, whether it be speaking, whether it be assembly. Those First Amendment rights, again, are going to be significantly suppressed as long as they talk about the ills of the regime. Those are going to be maintained. Social and economic issues I already talked about are still kind of fermenting as specifically the Russia goes through the Russo-Japanese War from 1903 to 1905, another boom and bust cycle for not just economic issues for Russia, but also agricultural issues because most of the food stuff is going towards the military forces, not feeding the people. So those forces at the bottom again start pushing more and more pressure on Nicholas to make more and more reforms. Now, what's interesting is that Nicholas, much like his father, wants to give a little. So he can't just be a bad guy with temporary regulations because that just looks too heinous, right? Nobody wants to be a bad czar. Everybody wants to be a good czar, right? The father of Russia. He wants everybody to love you. Another joke, right? So he's going to allow really the formulation of political parties. Now, if you kind of know how democracy and revolutions tend to happen, the last thing you want to do is allow some elements of freedom to kind of spontaneously, you know, burst onto the scene. Ask Gorbachev about that one, right? Because, again, old habits die hard in Russia, by the way. And he's going to allow political parties to start, but they start off, uniquely enough, as really labor unions. So remember when we talked about the Tsar Alexander allowing some grievance committees to kind of get together and talk about workers' rights? They're going to slowly transform into labor unions, which are going to slowly transform into political parties, and they're designed to really handle the social economic stress. And I'll talk about them in a second. You can see the names of them, and we're gonna let me give you some background. So we'll go with, you know, kind of radical, really radical, super radical. So leftists in Russia is kind of, you know, middle center, by the way, and then you move way far off to the left after that. And I'll go through these in pretty quick to kind of give you an idea. Peter Struve right here is the guy who's going to start the Union of Liberation. And it really is, what they want is really a constitutional monarch. So they like the Tsar, they think he's a good guy, but they think that he needs to have a check on him, meaning really a legislative or congressional check. And the idea that you have some assembly that's going to be there that makes recommendations, passes legislation, that can really talk about the ills of the people and handle that, and the Tsar can kind of do his Tsar stuff and kind of do the a queen wave or a Tsar wave and be good with it, right? And so they're the least radical in the sense that they don't want to remove the Tsar. They just want to add an extra layer of check onto the Tsar. But if you're the Tsar, is that a good idea? Well, no, someone's checking your power. You're the Tsar, right? You're ordained by God to be there. You guys don't get how this works, but this is good stuff, right? So we have Struve, and the Union of Liberation is going to evolve into the Cadet Party, which is the Constitutional Democratic Party. Or cadet, as is the acronym that they come to be called, and we'll see how they come into play because they play a significant role from February through October in 1917. All right, and actually Milikov is going to be the guy who's going to lead that in the early phases. the second party, right? So we have kind of radical, and now we have really radical, which is social democrats. Don't get fooled by the Democrat, all right? Democrat in the Russian sense, we're going to give everybody power, but really we only mean peasants and workers, by the way. Now, they do mean everybody in the fact that they aren't sexist in any regard, and for this purpose, anybody that works here as a peasant, you're good in our books. That's going to change, too, as you move through the revolution of 1917. Now, Milikov is this character right here. He's going to have a problem, though, in the fact that his party is a relatively large party, much larger than the cadets, by the way. The problem he has is that his party is controlled by two different factions. So you have a Bolshevik faction here and a Menshevik faction here. Bolsheviks are the ones you probably know most about, which is this guy, right? This is our good friend Lenin, right? A much younger Lenin, looking kind of, you know, hipster-esque, right? What was that? He looks good. The Bolsheviks are the faction of the Social Democrats that believe in Karl Marx, right? The idea of the workers' revolution, but they believe that you need this kind of supercharged cadre of revolutionaries to lead the people to revolution. So you can kind of circumvent the Marxist idea and kind of inject a catalyst in the system and promote the revolution. You know, it's much better than waiting around for the revolution to spontaneously happen. Now, the problem is that Martov and his Mensheviks believe, no, you have to follow Marx as he wrote, right? You have to allow the bourgeois system to develop, you have to allow the workers to develop, you have to allow the process of the proletariat to rise up and become aware. They don't believe in having a professional revolutionary class. So that's the major difference. And they completely have a beef with Plankov here. Because Plankov is a Marxist, but he doesn't know how to control these two, because these two end up taking control of the party in many regards. Now, last but not least, so you're kind of understanding that you have, you know, cadets being the guys that are sort of radical, right? And then you have Plankov, Lenin, and Martov, who are arguing about how to inject the revolution, make it happen now. And that now becomes either right now or, okay, maybe in a little while, but now. The last group here, the Social Revolutionary Party, the SR, is led by Chernov here, which he probably looks the most radical, right? Kind of crazy hair, ready to go right now. These guys, in many ways, are the evolutionary inheritors of the will of the people. They want revolution, and they want it now. They want to completely reorder society. They think that all the land owned by the landowners should be taken away and redistributed to the peasants. They believe that the czar should go away, and we should have this great democratic assembly. So they are the most radical, and these SRs also believe in the use of violence, bombings, assassinations, anarchist movements, whatever you do to get the system going. So you can see the scheme or the kind of spectrum of sort of radical, and then by the SRs you end up with a really radical. So this is what Nicholas has to deal with, is that the dynamic of the political system is becoming more and more dense and more focused, depending on if you want revolution right now, sort of in a little while, maybe sooner than later, or maybe just a constitutional democracy. So you have this process that's percolating up, and Nicholas doesn't really know how to handle the situation. Man, time flies too quick here. Okay. What's happening is that Nicholas is going to make the argument that, okay, much like his father, I'm going to give you a little. And a little is, he's going to make the argument that maybe we can have an assembly for the people, a representative assembly. But the problem is that this representative assembly really has no power. It's more of an advisory committee. And the advisory committee, it really is designed to be the Zemstvo Congress of 1904. So really, it's nobles and landowners. So again, if you're a peasant or a worker, where's your representation? You really don't have any, which is where the parties come into play. But the Tsar thinks that if I allow the Zemstvos to essentially merge it, so you pull all these local Zemstvos together and call them a representative assembly, you can now argue that we have civil liberties and we're arguing for the people, right? Well, sort of. If you're from the top, absolutely yes. If you're from the bottom, no. If you're a social democrat or social revolutionary, this is a little give, but we want real representation now. Let's make the jump to kind of 1905. So this is all happening really from 1900 to 1905. It's going to come to a head in January 1905 on January 22nd, which is now known as Bloody Sunday, led by this man, Father Gapon, who is a unique character in the fact that recent scholarship seems to indicate that he served in seminary, is a father, but ends up leaving the church for a variety of reasons. Mainly, he liked women, which is kind of current, right? He's also a deep cover spy for the Tsar's secret police. And he's also the head of a policeman's union, by the way. And only in Russia could this happen, right? That you have a guy who's a priest leading a union of policemen, but he's working for the Tsar's secret police. Because the idea, remember those temporary regulations? Those are still in check, so he has to kind of keep tabs on if anything bad's happening. So if the police are planning a strike, if they're planning maybe a coup against the palace guard, so on and so forth. But what's interesting is that Gapon's going to lead a march to the Tsar's winter palace on this date. And the intent is to give the Tsar really a letter that talks about moving this representative assembly into something that's more significant, much like a real Duma or a real legislative assembly. And again, he's not advocating revolution or dismissing the Tsar. His march is a peaceful march designed to go to the Tsar, say, I have a petition signed by all my folks, and it really is, let's talk about how we can make the system more representative and more democratic. The problem is, as you can see here, is that this peaceful march is soon joined as a march through the streets of St. Petersburg by social revolutionaries, the most radical kind of guys, right? Chernoff and those characters, and a bunch of anarchists who start throwing rocks and doing things that you probably shouldn't do on a peaceful march. The Tsar is going to respond by essentially, well, he's not even there, by the way, so let's leave that out. The response by the Tsar's police is essentially you fire on the crowd. Again, fine Russian tradition, Soviet tradition too, that if people are out protesting and doing things they shouldn't be doing, the way you suppress them is you either roll tanks in or you machine gun them. It's a method, right? And again, you can see the newsprint of the day. So again, that's that heavy hand. You've got to suppress them and give them a little something. So again, Bloody Sunday really is the first attempt at those political parties to kind of rise up and say, okay, we want something more. And again, Gapon wants to do it in a peaceful way, in a consultative kind of let's talk it out way. The problem is those forces, the Social Democrats, the Mensheviks, the Bolsheviks, and the social revolutionaries want it now. And they're going to see, and this is really known as kind of the first Russian revolution, the 1905 revolution, which is going to start the ball rolling. So those Bolsheviks and Mensheviks are going to use this as an example to see you can't negotiate with the Tsar. You have to bring power and bring change now. How am I doing on time? All right, Gates? All right, so Nicholas is dealing with that, which he doesn't quite know what to do. So he's going to call for the consultative assembly. So again, what he sees is, okay, he feels really bad, by the way, about his policemen shooting people in the open streets, which is kind of a good thing, right? So he's going to say, okay, I'm going to give you the consultative assembly. But again, the problem is it's made up of folks that don't have the best interests of the workers or peasants in it. So again, the social democrats and the social revolutionaries are not going to be real happy about it. But again, this is another one of those off-ramps. The Tsar thinks he's suppressing the tension, right? Think about it as like a pressure cooker. The Tsar believes this is a pressure valve, but the reality is it's anything but. So from his perspective, I'm handling it, I'm dealing with it. The reality is it's just seething underneath. This is going to happen in the spring of 1905. By the summer of 1905, there's going to be open revolution on the high seas, mainly the Black Seas in Russia. How many of you have seen the movie Battleship Potemkin, right, the Eisenstein classic? The real story is even better than the movie, by the way. And what's going to happen, I'll kind of condense it so we can get to the real revolution, right? This is just kind of the prelude to the revolution, the little revolution, little R revolution. We'll get to the big revolution in a second. That what happens is Battleship Potemkin here is, one of the grand jewels of the Black Sea Fleet. And the soldiers and sailors on board are forced to eat really bad food, right? Think about the worst meal you ever had. These guys are eating it, specifically the meat on this day that they're fed in June 1905 is full of maggots, by the way. And the people elect a sailor by the name of Valenshek to go talk to the XO of the ship and protest the meat and say, hey, it's unfit for human consumption. The XO of the ship petitions the ship's doctor for a ruling on the meat, and the doctor's going to say, no, it's fine. Fit for human consumption. Belenshek is going to go back to the people and say, hey, or the sailors and say, hey, doctor said the meat's fine. The people are like, oh, no. There's maggots on this meat. So they go back to the XO again. The XO of the ship is not very happy about this. Valenshek's going to give another spiel about how you need to treat people with respect and not feed them maggots. XO of the ship is not going to be happy about this and is going to pull out a pistol and shoot him. You don't want any mutiny on the high seas, right? What happens after that little episode is that the sailors are going to rush in and they're going to throw the XO overboard with the doctor who ruled the meat fit for human consumption, by the way, and they're going to shoot them both. Kind of radical, right? So once they throw the XO over and the doctor over and shoot them, they're going to round up all the officers and lock them in the brig and essentially take control of the ship. And the ship is going to be controlled by, really, social democrats and social revolutionaries. And this is significant because if you think about this, right, you now have a crown jewel of the Tsar's Navy being controlled by radicals. So the ship's going to sail towards Odessa, right on the Black Sea, think Ukraine, right? And what's happening in Odessa is there's open street fighting taking place, and the social democrats and social revolutionaries are leading the charge. And what the Potemkin does is they pull into port essentially, and they radio the portmaster and say, okay, we're here to suppress the revolution, support our brothers, because there are Cossacks and secret police kind of hanging around, and if you don't let our brothers kind of do what they need to do, we're going to fire upon the city. In the meantime, they're going to take Valenshek's body and lay it on the steps, which is kind of in downtown Odessa. It's going to become a shrine for the revolution, and within 4 or 5 days, the general strike that's happening in Odessa is going to take off, and there's going to be open street fighting even larger and bigger. The Tsar is going to get word of this and call in more police, more army, and more Cossacks, and they're going to end up killing 2,000 folks and wounding another 3,000 folks. Now, what's interesting is that despite the fact that the SRs and SDs have control of the ship, they never fire on Odessa because why? Anybody want to guess? It's a port, but their brothers and sisters are revolting there, and they're being slaughtered by the Tsar. So they end up leaving and going to Romania. They cut a deal, and this is kind of condensed. They cut a deal with the Romanians. They give them safe passage, and they scuttle the ship and leave it be. Some of these folks are going to come back during 1917 and kind of, relive the glory days. But again, the Tsar thinks that, okay, I thought I handled it, but after this, after Potemkin, he's going to have to make a significant change to the system of the Soviet Union. So he's going to say, okay, consultative assembly maybe wasn't the right pressure valve. Let's go with a Duma. And a Duma is, think about the U.S. Congress. It's an attempt to have a legislative assembly where the people will have a voice. Each party will have votes, and you can have X number of seats for the cadets, X number of seats for the social democrats, and you can form a coalition government in many ways. But the problem is, the Tsar says, I like this democracy thing, but really, I don't want to give up control. So the Duma, although elected by the people, is still only have really consultative powers. So you can only advise me, I still retain most of the power. Which, again, the Tsar thinks this is a half step that's going to appease the situation, but the reality is, if you're a social revolutionary or a social democrat, it's another small step when you think the time is right for the big step. So as we're really ramping up to 1917, is that this Duma is significant because it really changes the nature of the Russian regime and the fact that the Tsar is now going to be checked by a constitutional assembly in many ways. And the powers are going to ebb and flow from 1906 through 1917. And what's unique is the first Duma is only going to last like 73 days. And the problem is the Tsar maintains the right to abolish the Duma. So when he sees that there's open fighting on the first day of the Duma, right, because the social democrats want something now, the social revolutionaries want something different, the cadets want something, and you have the Octoberists and a whole bunch of other parties forming, he says, this is stalemate. You all go home and just chill out again. So again, 73 days. And he's going to allow the second Duma to come back roughly a year later. It's going to last 63 days, by the way. So the first two attempts at this new governmental form are going to objectively fail, mainly because the social democrats and social revolutionaries want radical change and they want it now. The other parties in the system tend to be more centrist and want slow, controlled growth. Really, they want slow check on the czar. The SDs and SRs want the czar gone. Now, what's interesting, between the second Duma and third Duma, the czar is going to get together with his ministers and have a chat about why aren't these Dumas working the way they're supposed to be working. And the blame is going to be laid squarely on the Social Democrats, the Mensheviks, the Bolsheviks, and the Social Revolutionaries. So what they do is they change the voting rules, which was going to suppress the Social Democrats and Social Revolutionaries' representation in the Duma. So what happens is you get much more conservative and centrist forces, partisan actors, in the third and fourth Dumas, and they work pretty well up until 1917. And then I'll give you Gates Brown. Sorry about that.
So when we think about 1917, this is what we think about. You've got Lenin, he looks angry. You've got red flags behind him, and it seems like the people, as Dr. Kalic said, the people want change, the people need change. This is finally going to be the change that people have advocated for. It seems almost irresistible. However, that doesn't leave much room for contingency. It doesn't leave much room for the role of chance. And so what we're going to do tonight is talk about 1917 through three different questions. And hopefully these questions will allow us to add a little bit of nuance into the revolution, allow us to understand why in some cases what happens in February is really the revolution, and a better way to think about October 1917 is less of a revolution and more of a coup. So three questions. Why is 1917 so different from 1905? Why does the provisional government struggle so much? If it seems to be a representative body, it seems to have some claim to legitimacy. Why can't it get it together? And then finally, why do the Bolsheviks, a minority socialist party, come out on top? But first we have to get Nicholas off the throne. 1917, the war effort is not going well. But by 1917, the war effort's really not going well for anybody. Russia's worked hard to overcome a lot of the problems that plagued its early military operations in terms of supply. Still struggling, though, still struggling with industrialization. You can make some advances, but you can't ever really hold on to that momentum, and you can't hold on to territory. So by 1917, the Germans have pushed into Russian territory, but maybe if you had a better government, maybe you could have a better war policy. 1905, you had a failed war, though. So in 1917, the war is not failing. It's not over. It's not going well. 1905, you lose the Russo-Japanese War. You lose a war that everyone thinks you should win. So we can't just look at the war as the only reason for change in 1917. Dr. Kalic talked about some of these internal problems going on in 1905, the different political parties evolving, different political parties pushing for radical changes. In 1917, you still have many of those same actors. You still have a Duma. It's less radical, but those radicals haven't gone away. They've changed their emphasis, and we'll see how they're going to come about in a different representative body in 1917, but you still have those similar issues between 1905 in 1917. What really is going to change 1917 and why the monarchy ends in 1917 and not 1905 is because of the decision that Nicholas makes. The protests that are going to ultimately be his downfall start as a result of frustration that workers have about their inability to buy bread. They're working long hours, they're getting paid, and the reason they want to have these jobs is obviously to feed their families, to house their families. But in the capital, bread, food is harder and harder to come by. Again, it's not really a supply issue, it's more mismanagement. You have granaries that are full, but it's tough to get fuel into the capital for the state bakeries. One thing about the capital, it's St. Petersburg before the war, but that sounds a little too German, so now it's going to be Petrograd. during the war. And so we'll try to maintain that, but we're talking about the same place, St. Petersburg and Petrograd. So the protests begin not really revolutionary in character. The workers just want the ability to take their wages and turn it into food. After the first day or two of protests, the Tsar needs to go back to the front because in 1915, he felt that his commanders were not leading effectively, and really the best place for the Tsar, the commander-in-chief of the Russian forces, was at the front with his men. And so against the advice of his advisors, he leaves and becomes the commander at the front for the Russian army. And so in 1917, when he's faced with this domestic disturbance, his ministers tell him that there's really no reason to be concerned. These protests don't look like they're really out of the ordinary, and we think we have a good handle on how we can solve them. And so Nicholas is going to leave the capital. He's going to be updated on the protests as they continue to evolve, but as Dr. Kalic mentioned about these off-ramps, pressure valves, those are all part of this disconnect. The Tsar thinks that he understands the people of Russia because he's their leader, he's their father. But what we see is his ministers and the Tsar aren't reading the streets very well because it is unique. These protests are of a different character than previous unrest. There are going to be a couple of things that really inflame the protest. There's a rumor that the government's going to reduce the bread ration, and so it causes a run on state bakeries. So even the limited amount of bread that was available for purchase is now gone, further inflames the problem. There's an international women's conference in the capital that brings women to the protest. So it's now not just workers, but also women advocating for change. The weather is going to frustrate things for the government, not for the protesters. It actually gets to be unseasonably warm for winter in Petrograd, about 46 degrees Fahrenheit. And so people can come out and enjoy the beautiful weather and also take part in the protest. As the protests swell over a matter of days, they go to over 200,000 people in the capital. And you start to get more radical agitators. You start to have banners that are calling for revolution. The folks in the Duma, even though it's a more conservative body than some of the folks we'll discuss in a little bit, they're calling for changes. Nobody's calling for revolution from the Duma, but they're asking the government to really take to heart these concerns that the people have. The Tsar's ministers feel like now is the time to act. They're continuing to update Nicholas on the situation, and they say, well, we think we can provide security. And Nicholas says, well, if you think it can solve the problem, then by all means, do so. As Dr. Kalic said, old habits die hard, and so the best way to handle these disturbances is with security forces. When we talked about Bloody Sunday, the folks doing the firing are soldiers. And if you're going to rely on the military to provide domestic security, you need to make sure that those soldiers are more sympathetic to the regime than they are to the people that they're going to be suppressing. And so one of the big differences in the soldiers from 1905 to 1917 is by 1917, those loyal veteran soldiers, they're on the front, they're dead, or they're invalided because of wounds from the war. So the people who receive the order to go out and suppress these demonstrations are new recruits. Petrograd is a depot city. So if you get your conscription notice, you're going to go to Petrograd. You're going to be issued a uniform, given some rudimentary training, formed into a unit, and sent to the front. There are also some reservists, militia guys, who've done their bit for king and country, but because of the manpower shortages you're facing in Russia in 1917, you're scraping the bottom of the barrel. You need to reactivate these folks. They're older. They have families, they have jobs, and now they're being called to leave those responsibilities and go fight for Russia. They're frustrated. Both of these groups, weeks before, were civilians. And now they're being called on to violently suppress demonstrations that they probably have a great deal of sympathy with. Now, the first day of suppression goes reasonably well for the government. It seems like everything is okay. Because in addition to the violence, the government lets the workers know if they don't report to work on the following day, they'll lose their draft deferments, and they'll be subject to conscription, which means you're going to the front. And so at the end of the day of the first suppression, the streets are calm. But what happens overnight in these military units is they start to discuss how they should respond to future orders for future suppression. And this is where the involvement of a group that Dr. Kalic mentioned, the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks, these socialist parties, starts to manifest itself in a troubling way for 1917 and the Tsar. You see, the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks had looked at the soldiers as really being tools of this imperialist war. And so they need to try to educate these soldiers so that they can understand they're fighting for their own oppressors. And the soldiers start to take some agency of their own after that first day. And they realize, well, we don't want to be tools of our oppressors. We want to maybe join these protests. And so some units will actively support the protest with their weapons. Other units will decide that they're maybe not going to take an active part in the protest, but they're also not going to suppress the protest. So it's a mutiny, but not quite as radical as a mutiny as actually joining the protest. So the next day, the protesters come back, but now they have armed soldiers with them. And the troops in the capital are no longer going to be riding out to put down the protest. And now the government realizes they have a serious problem. And so they're radioing to the Tsar, asking him to please help. This has gotten out of hand. Our first effort for security didn't go well. Again, you go with what you're comfortable with. You know where to find veteran troops on the front. So you'll send some regiments back to the capital under the leadership of a trusted general, and they'll definitely be able to put down this insurrection quickly. So the Tsar gives the orders. There's going to be a couple of days in between the military unit arriving at the capital and the Tsar getting there, because the Tsar doesn't want to inflame the situation. He just wants to arrive at a secure capital. But the Duma representatives are thinking of other ways to resolve this issue, because the Duma feels like they have the pulse of the people. They understand what the people want. And so they send representatives to the Tsar and let him know that the best way to solve this problem is for you to abdicate. The Tsar is uncomfortable with this solution. So he reaches out to folks that he trusts, senior army commanders, and asks them for their opinion, because this is going to be a significant sacrifice. But if this is what's needed for Russia for the war effort, then maybe he can understand it. But if it's just something that some opportunistic politicians are advocating so that they can get a leg up, well, he's not going to give them the time of day. But the Duma had already thought about that. And the Duma representatives were reaching out to army commanders and letting them know that really abdication would be a viable policy. That if the Tsar goes away, that maybe we can have a chance at a functional and viable government. Not revolution. He'd abdicate for his son, or he'd abdicate for his brother, or maybe another Romanov. It wouldn't be a revolution. It would just be removal of the problematic Tsar and get in a Tsar who maybe would be more malleable, more open to some of those restrictions that Dr. Kalic talked about, that some of those more conservative parties in the Duma want to put around the Tsar. And so when the Tsar is presented with this information from his senior commanders, he agrees. And that's really where the revolution starts. It's kind of amazing that you don't have any forces really fighting for the Tsar at that moment. Nobody's standing up and saying, no, this can't happen. The Tsar decides to leave, and that's the revolution. But you have to abdicate for something. And initially, it's going to be his son. His son has some health problems, and the Tsar is talking with the Duma representatives, kind of thinking out loud, and he's saying, well, I want my son to live with me. And they tell him, no, you can't have your son and be a deposed monarch. Your son will need to live somewhere else. He'll be under a regency, but you can't live with him. Well, his son suffers from hemophilia, and he wants his son with the family. So he says, fine, I'm going to abdicate for my son and myself. So now the crown will go to his brother. His brother steps back and says, well, I'd really like to accept this, but I'll wait until there's an elected government from Russia that offers me the crown, and then I'll accept it. And so this interregnum, because you don't have a constituent assembly, you don't have anybody who's elected to represent the people. So who is going to take charge until you can have this constituent assembly? It's going to be the Duma. And the Duma is going to form a provisional government cabinet. The problem that the Duma has, though, is they weren't elected to be a government. As Dr. Kalic talked about, they're really more of an advisory body. They can say yes, they can say no, they can be dismissed at any time. And so there's a sense from the Duma leaders that they don't really have much legitimacy. They need to have some way to tap into a representative body, but it's going to take a long time to get the legal framework for these elections. How do you kind of short-circuit this process and get some democratic legitimacy? There happens to be a relatively new group in the streets of the capital after the fall of the Tsar, the Petrograd Soviet. Now, we've all heard of the Soviet Union. The Soviets are these representative bodies that workers form in the capital, and the Soviets are a union, but they're also much more of a political group to represent this class of workers. And they're democratically elected. There's going to be an executive body, because the Soviets are really kind of unmanageable. You have thousands of workers, and you have hundreds of representatives, and it's really not an effective way to run a representative group. So you've got an elective or an executive committee, the Ispolkom, and it's going to be made up of all the different parties inside of the Soviet, particularly the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks. This man here is Alexander Kerensky. Alexander Kerensky is a member of the Soviet. He's also a member of the executive committee. Now, what's interesting is when you think about a worker in Petrograd in the early 20th century, you think of someone who has lived kind of a tough life because it's not an easy go to be a worker. But the members of the executive committee aren't really workers. They are political agitators. And so Kerensky is a politician, but he's there to help the workers. He wants to be part of this provisional government, but the Soviet, as a rule, has said that they're not going to cooperate with the provisional government because it's probably going to be a bourgeois element. It's probably going to be counter-revolutionary. It's going to subvert this nascent revolution that maybe the people have a chance to really grab Russia and direct it towards their own ends. But Kerensky takes this case not just to the executive committee but to the entire Soviet and makes an impassioned speech for why he should be part of this new government. And he's going to be the war minister of the provisional government. Now, the provisional government reaches out to the Soviet because, again, the Soviet has some democratic legitimacy, and asks the Soviet to condone, to approve of its policies. So that way, the provisional government can issue these directives not just in their own assumed authority, but also with some kind of a mantle of democracy. And the provisional government agrees. They say, well, yes, we'll agree with the things that we think support us, but this is not reciprocal. We maintain the right to disagree. We maintain the right to make policies counter to the provisional government. And you see this in the first order that the Petrograd Soviet issues. There are a number of parts of this order, but we'll only talk about a couple of them. One is that soldiers now can ride inside streetcars, which may seem trivial, but in the capital, they couldn't ride in streetcars. They had to ride on the outside of streetcars. So now soldiers have more rights that normal citizens in Petrograd would have. Officers can't talk down to soldiers anymore. They can't use the diminutive, informal, second-person tone. They have to speak to them as equals. Also, soldiers don't have to use honorifics. Officers in the Russian army had some degree of nobility for the most part, and so instead of their rank, you would refer to them as their title. So Your Excellency, Your Highness, something to that effect. Now, refer to them as their rank, because, again, you're both soldiers. Nobility doesn't matter anymore. So all those things are an effort to kind of show the soldiers that they're really trying to look out for their own interests. There are some more troubling things, though, and that is each unit at the regiment level and below should create its own Soviet. And these Soviets should elect representatives to go to the Petrograd Soviet. That's not too bad. You know, the Soviet's trying to represent the workers, and the best way to do that is to get representatives from the units that can actually talk with real authoritative knowledge about what's going on. More troubling, though, is that these new military Soviets had to take ownership of the weapons of the unit and only allow them to be used with the approval of the Petrograd Soviet. So from the beginning, the Petrograd Soviet is eroding one of the functions of a government, which is the monopoly on the use of force. And there's really nothing that the provisional government can do about that. Because again, it's reached out to the Soviet and asked it to provide some legitimacy. And so now you can't really back away. There are some other issues that the provisional government is going to struggle with in terms of philosophy. Again, they're elected as Duma representatives really to provide advice and consent to the Tsar. Now they've assumed the responsibility to lead Russia. And they're uncomfortable with this. And so philosophically, they take kind of a hands-off approach. They don't want to provide all the direction that the strong central government provided under the Tsar. They want organic solutions to come from the ground up. Well, if you've got a people and a government system that is designed around very definitive directives from a central government, a strong controlling hand, and all of a sudden that hand is removed, the people on the bottom might start to think that the government's not doing the things that it should do because it can't, and not because you should come up with your own solutions. And so it can kind of look like anarchy from that ground level. And the provisional government is going to struggle to really tap into the loyalty of the Russian people because it doesn't seem like the government's really doing much governing. Kerensky has a solution for that. In the summer of 1917, in July, he thinks that what the people need to really believe in the provisional government is a successful military offensive. Because if we can turn the war effort around, then maybe we can get the people to realize how effective this new government is. And so he launches the Kerensky, what's going to be called the Kerensky Offensive. It's going to be in the southern part of the Russian-Austrian front and goes pretty well for the first couple of days. The Russian push actually gains some ground. The Germans realize that the Austrians are collapsing and so sends reinforcements. And at the sight of German troops, the Russian soldiers flee. So again, it's that systemic problem that the Russians have faced. You can make some initial gains, but you can't hold on to them. And this leads to massive demonstrations in the capital as a result of this failed offensive. And it's one of the first opportunities that Lenin sees to take power. What's interesting is how Lenin gets back to Russia. At the fall of the Tsar, the Germans realize they've got an opportunity. And so they have somebody on the payroll who's been involved and so in Russian politics for quite a while. Lenin. He's cooling his heels in Switzerland, but he needs to get into Russia. And so the Germans are going to put him on a train that's not going to make any stops. It's going to be secret and sealed, and they're going to move him to the border of Russia so he can get in and continue this agitation. And in fact, Lenin is going to stay on the German payroll, and the Bolshevik Party is going to stay on the German payroll as kind of an information operation. Well, what causes Lenin to pull back at that final moment is the provisional government, which is going to be led by Kerensky after July, publishes the fact that Lenin and the Bolsheviks are on the German payroll. And so Lenin pulls back, feels like he's lost the ability to really gain control of the revolution. He goes into hiding. Many Bolsheviks are arrested, but they're not really prosecuted to the degree that you would expect a revolutionary group to be prosecuted. And one of the reasons for that is, remember, Kerensky is a member of the Petrograd Soviet. The Bolsheviks are members of the Petrograd Soviet. He's not really worried about a counter-revolution from the left, which would be from a Bolshevik group. He's worried about a counter-revolution from the right. And we see that in the Petrograd Soviet's first order. That's why they were so intent on keeping those arms away from the officer corps. That's why those military Soviets had to maintain possession of the weapons of a unit. Because the Soviet, guys like Kerensky, are worried that the officers will take the army, attack this revolution, and put the Tsar back in power. And so that's why Kerensky's not really going to go after the Bolsheviks with a heavy hand, because he's still worried about the army. Now, after the July days, the first prime minister of the provisional government, Prince Lvov, is going to remove himself because he feels like he's lost confidence, and in all aspects he has. Kerensky's going to step up. Kerensky looks like he could form a socialist government, something that would be kind of in the middle between a Bolshevik takeover and return to a constitutional monarchy, a cabinet of socialists. And he fills it with other socialist members. But he doesn't really address the main problem, and that is that the Bolsheviks are single, their single focus is on attaining power. And that's one of the big reasons why the Bolsheviks come out on top. It's not that they had a lot of support from the people. It's not that they commanded large electoral margins. It's that they're the party with a single-minded focus on gaining power. And we see this when Lenin gets back into Russia. There's a conversation in the Petrograd Soviet, and there's some frustration because none of the other socialist parties really, none of the socialist parties want to take ownership. They don't want to be in charge. And this is a problem because the revolution doesn't really seem to be going anywhere for the workers. Lenin reminds the speaker of the Petrograd Soviet that there is a socialist party that wants to be in charge. After the July days, Lenin is in Finland. Trotsky is still in Russia. He is going to be the guy that's really going to provide a lot of the direction and a lot of the organizing for October. The thing that really sets the deadline is the government, the provisional government, announces they're going to have constituent assembly elections in November. So now, as a Bolshevik, you know, well, if we're going to take over this revolution, it has to be before November. There's some disagreement, though, in the Bolshevik Party. Do you let assembly elections happen and then hope the Bolsheviks come out on top, and that's how you're going to take control of the revolution? Or if you're Lenin, do you try to take control of the government before the elections? Because Lenin understands that if it's about electoral wins, the Bolsheviks aren't going to be the majority party. And it's going to be much more difficult to try to roll back valid elections. Much better to just announce your revolution, take control of the government, and then let the chips fall where they may. The way that the Bolsheviks are able to take control is as you get into the fall of 1917, the Soviets worried about the government leaving the capital and allowing the Germans to come in and destroy the Soviet. And so the Mensheviks advance a resolution to create a revolutionary military committee whose function will be to safeguard the revolution, the Soviet, from foreign enemies. The Bolsheviks initially are skeptical of this proposal, but they realize with a small tweak it could actually work out to their advantage. And so they advance an amendment. And they say, we'll support it, but we would like it to be both foreign and domestic. That way, the revolution is secured from all sides. And the Mensheviks realize that this really is going to be more of a power grab for the Bolsheviks, because if this revolutionary military committee can protect the revolution from both foreign and domestic enemies, then once it deems an enemy as a domestic threat, it'll have the ability to attack it. And so the Mensheviks try to pull this resolution back, but it's too late. It's got too much momentum, and so the Bolsheviks end up in charge of this revolutionary military committee. And so when you've got that deadline of constituent assembly elections in November, now you've got a reason to act, and you've got the tool to use. The revolutionary military committee is in touch with garrison units in the capital, because remember, the Soviet represents not only workers but also soldiers. And so the Soviet communicates to units in the capital that the Revolutionary Military Committee deems the provisional government a threat to the revolution. And so what happens is the Revolutionary Military Committee members show up to strategic offices like the telegraph office, to other government buildings, and they relieve the guards. They say, you can go home, we'll take over from here. And on the night of October 24th through 25th, this happens. And so when the sun rises on 25 October, all of the buildings, except for really the Winter Palace, which is where Kerensky, as prime minister, is holed up. And Kerensky realizes that he's got a significant problem. So he reaches out to the military for support. The problem, though, is he's already alienated the military. There's an issue with General Kornilov. We don't have time to really go into it, but in August of 1917, Kornilov moves a corps towards the capital. Now, from General Kornilov's perspective, he's the commander-in-chief of Russian forces, and he believes Kerensky's ordered him to move this force in to protect the capital. Kerensky views this as a possible counter-revolution and accuses Kornilov of treason. And so what happens is the military largely removes themselves from these political issues. They'll just stay out of it. They'll wait until these things sort themselves out, and whenever government ends up leading Russia, that'll be the government that the military backs. And so when Kerensky reaches out for military help, he actually reaches out to Kornilov, whom he'd accused of treason, and Kornilov doesn't come. Now, the Bolsheviks do have some military power. They've got a cruiser in the port, and they're going to fire blank rounds. So the problem is, if you're in the Winter Palace, it's hard to really understand that those are blank shots. Maybe they're just ill-aimed. There are also artillery in the Peter and Paul Fortress that's adjacent to the Winter Palace, and even though those shots aren't well-aimed, they do hit the palace. And so after a short time, the government, the provisional government in the Winter Palace, realizes that there's no force coming to save it, and they surrender. But why don't others resist this coup? Why is everybody willing to accept the Bolsheviks as the new government of Russia? Because there are a lot of other parts. Remember, this is just one capital. There's the other 99% of Russia that hasn't been polled on this, that really hasn't been challenged in terms of who's going to lead the country. Well, it's because Lenin is able to make promises to anyone. So if you're a peasant and you really want agrarian reform because you feel like that's going to be the thing that changes society, well, sure. Peasants should own land. We'll take from landowners and give to peasants. That's not a problem. Unstated is that when the state collectivizes all of the land, no one will own anything. Soldiers, similarly, they want peace. Fine, the Bolsheviks will have peace at any price. They'll get out of the war. Definitely, soldiers deserve a rest. Unstated is that this is the beginning of a worldwide revolution. In the next war, you will have no alternative but to fight. Ethnic groups that want their own state, you know, Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, sure, ethnic minorities should be able to have their own states, of course. Unstated, though, is that these will just be lines on a map. And what's really going to matter when the Bolsheviks take power is the party is going to rule. So you can have your own state, but you'll have no say over what party controls it. Workers want ownership of the factory, of course. But when the state comes to collectivize, there will be no ability to resist. So Lenin understands you can make any promises you want because by the time that these groups come to collect, you'll have power solidified and there will be no ability to resist. Because like Dr. Kalic discussed, this idea of secret police, it starts with the Tsar. It's only going to increase with the Bolsheviks. When we look at what 1917 does for World War I, the Bolsheviks are going to get peace in 1918. And so in a sense, the German investment in Lenin and in the Bolsheviks pays off because now they've got one front that is peaceful. They can shift all their resources over to the West, but it's too late. What it means for Russia is there's going to be a totalitarian regime in place for much of the rest of the 20th century. And so those temporary measures that were only going to last 3 months, well, they've continued through Nicholas They're going to continue with the Bolsheviks, and they're only going to get more punitive and more violent. In terms of the world, communism is going to be one of the three ideologies that's going to push conflict throughout the rest of the 20th century. So we'll have communism, capitalism, and fascism fight in World War II. And then after World War II, you'll have the conflict of capitalism and communism until the fall of the Soviet Union. So when we look at 1917, I encourage you, don't just jump to October. Remember that the revolution, in some sense, happens in the early part of the year. And what really allows the Bolsheviks to gain power is not that they had a mandate from the people. It's not that they're representing this oppressed people, or that they've tapped into what the Russian people really want, what they strove from the late 19th century to 1917 to get. It's that the Bolsheviks were the party who had a single-minded focus on gaining power and were willing to do what it took when other parties wanted to stand off to the side and critique because they didn't want the responsibility of power, or in the provisional government's case, were willing to make problematic compromises to gain some democratic legitimacy. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know that our folks right here have to leave. Thank you very much. And I know that we are tight on time, so we are going to take one question this evening, and then all other questions we'll answer in the lobby. I know both of these gentlemen will be happy to respond to any questions that you might have. You'll notice that there are microphones down here on the left and the right. Gentlemen, you all are so quiet. Thank you so much for being here as well, and potentially the quietest exit that we have had from the auditorium, and I'm totally giving you away because I've got the microphone, and that's going to be on YouTube as well. You can thank me for that, gentlemen. All right, our question will be from this gentleman on our left.
Good evening. I was wondering if you could give me a date when each of you feel the revolution truly was over in Russia.
All right. Well, I'll go first, and then Dr. Kalic can correct me. So if you're talking about the revolution as when the Bolsheviks finally consolidate power and when everybody agrees that yes, this is something that we're all gonna have to recognize whether we like it or not, 1921, 1922, when the Civil War ends. Because one thing we're unable to talk about is after this, yes, the Bolsheviks have control of the government, but there's a lot of disaffected folks that are going to continue to contest this. And so the Civil War is going to go on for 4 or 5 years.
I would agree, but I think I would take it a little further. Because if you really want the Bolsheviks to kind of solidify power and kind of get the, I guess, social, political system they want, I'm going to argue at least through the 1930s as they're industrializing and go through collectivization. So I'd put it probably around 33.
And one of the questions I consistently get asked is, what year, right? I get asked what year World War I actually ends. Is it 1918, 1919, 1923? But one might argue that it has yet to end. So I would encourage you to come back and look at the galleries or come to more programs. If you're looking for your holiday shopping, consider becoming a member. And please join me in thanking Dr. Brown and Dr. Kalic.